first obstacle for us was finding the right dynamic of people, meaning it took us 6 to 8 years of different arrangements of the group, from different singers back when I was on the drum set to different bass players before Daniel finally gave in and joined the band, because we were friends and I played in bands with him separately, but he never joined our band until a few years later. And then it also took a founding member, another guitar player named Josh, leaving the band. And then it weeded down to the three of us. That's why we have these scars on our shoulder. We did these burn marks with the back end of a knife over a stove for every year of touring. It was like a pact that we made with each other. And at the end of all these years, it was just the three of us, Daniel, Mark, and myself. And so we left it at three burn marks. And that was the first obstacle to get over. And we're like, oh, this feels right. When we write, it flows. These ideas that are coming out feel real and genuine. And then all the other dynamics we had had up until that point, the songs just weren't coming out right. And so that was the first big one. Good question. I would say the best advice has been rely on yourself. Look for the answers in here before you waste all of your energy and time trying to find them out there, because everyone else is trying to make their own thing work too. You know, you're gonna waste your time doing that. The right people will show up once you've built your thing. So, you know that saying from what's that little baseball movie? Build it and they will come.
Yeah.
That's the best advice. Just focus on building your own thing. And the worst advice was probably, let me think, write a hit. You know, because everybody gets so focused on, you know, we go in the rehearsal room and we're like, let's write that hit. And I think so many people fall into this bad advice or say that phrase, is that in hindsight, it's true. That's what a post-analysis after a band has launched into success, it's clear that all of them, they have this one song usually that's the most identifiable one that cracked open the egg for their career. And while that's true that happened, that it's not true that is advice that you should give or where you should aim. Because as soon as you give that advice to a band, their priorities and the heart and the soul and really the core of the creative process gets unaligned and misprioritized. And you're so focused on the hit or the single that you're actually writing from a place that would never write a true hit. A real hit is something that resonates with people. And in order to do that, you have to resonate with yourself first. And that means digging deep into your emotions and your experiences and your humanity, not into chasing this golden goose somewhere out there in the world, like writing a hit. And so you end up writing all these bullshit songs that are, it's like chasing girls. Don't chase girls. Become the man and let the girls come to you. It's the same principle. I would say stop being a pussy, get over your fears, be humble. Don't let your pride get in the way. Because I, for the longest time, my fears held me back from singing. I was very afraid to get in front of people and do that. And I was probably a little prideful in my own. I thought I was smart enough, or I thought I was talented enough, because I had to put in a lot of hours. But I still was not coming from a humble place when I would meet certain people that could have taught me something. Being humble actually allows you to propel forward faster. rather than being prideful. Necessity, I think, was a big part of it. Like, we had gone through multiple singers, and it was, my passion for music was very strong, but the only thing between me and a career in music was a singer, unless we wanted to be an instrumental band, which you're not going to have much of a career. I mean, some bands do it, but it's rare. And so I was like, well, again, I keep looking in the outside world. I keep trying to find someone else to do it. And I was like, well, I got to get a job or go to college or do something, because I'm barely paying the bills here. And it basically came down to that feeling of my back is against the wall. What do I do? And I told myself, I do not want to regret on my deathbed having never tried. If I try, at least I can know that I gave it everything I got. And so that's been my biggest force of change, I think, in any aspect of life, and in that situation especially, was saying, if I can honestly look at myself and say I gave it everything I had and it just didn't work, then I'll find out a reason it didn't work, and that will lead me down a different path, or it's gonna work, and I'm gonna be happy that I did, and that was what led me here. I think, I think to my family, the Grammy nominations, we got 3 this year, which was really a big deal for the first time ever getting 3 of them. I think making my dad and my family members like proud, because they had, you know, my dad bought me a drum set when I was a kid and had to bear with me clanging and banging for years. So to hear how much that, in his mind, that was it, you know, because people know that name, the Grammys.
Yeah.
But other than that, I would say, you know, my girlfriend that I'm with right now, she's a huge pride and joy to me that I don't think, I wouldn't have met her had I not chased this, because I wouldn't have been out there in the world and be in a position to meet someone like that. And so she's the girl of my dreams, and it's pretty awesome. Yeah, that's a good question. You know, I would say that I've learned that in different phases of my life, it's different things. And so there's 2 parts to this. The one part is the goal. It's kind of the linchpin. Like, you have a map and you put a pin. There's my goal. But that's all it is. It's just a pin. It doesn't always motivate you, because there are so many times along the journey where you're just fucking tired and you're sick of it and you really just want to do something else or go home. So the goal doesn't motivate you enough. But the goal's kind of that anchor that if you try a string to where you are now and where the goal is, from here to here, it was, the motivation was just pure love of the music, the feeling that it gave you. And then after enough time and playing night after night after night, sometimes that will kind of fade away or not be there every night. So from here to here on the journey, then it was like just primal things like being fed or making money or girls or attention, you know, those kind of things that when you're a kid you kind of wish that you had. And then when that kind of wears off from here to here, then it's like being a master at your craft or having pride in what you do. And so I don't ever think there's a wrong way to motivate yourself. Like, I think that use every force that you have in any given moment, even the negative ones. Like when my mom was dying of cancer, I used every ounce of all those negative feelings I felt and put it into the music. And so when you have that goal, everything that happens in your life along the way, you keep channeling them back into that goal. And so that to me is what It's those two things combined that create the journey. Damn, that's a tough one. I'm gonna have to think for a second.
That's a good one.
I would say, was there ever a time that I knew something but had no clear reason that I knew that, or when I seemed crazy to everyone else but I was right and I found out later? I guess it'd be like to be asked that, because there was a few pivotal moments in my life, and I think everyone probably has these kind of experiences at some point in their life where you just, something in you just knows, I need to go that way. I don't know why, but it's something in your gut or your intuition. It's something I've been thinking about a lot lately, because I feel like it's not every day that you feel that, but every once in a while on your journey, you get that. And I think it's really important to follow that, because I'll give you one example. There's many times this happened throughout my life, but I went to this camp one summer, and this was in middle school, and it was the first time I ever played on stage, drum set in like a full rock band for like a talent show. And I got this rush. It was just like this unbelievable feeling. And for some reason, after that show, I had just changed schools before then, by request, because there was a bigger, better school that had more music programs, and I told my parents I wanted to go there. And so I got this feeling, I was like, there's this one school that I just met somebody who went there, and I didn't know why, but I was like, I need to go to that school. I just know, as a seventh grader. And so I came home from this summer camp, told my parents, y'all just have to trust me. I just need to go to that school. And fortunately, they trusted me. I don't know, you know, why, but, and when I went, the very first day, I met Daniel, my bass player, but I had no idea I was going to meet him. You know what I mean? Yeah. And we weren't even in a band together for years, and he went off to college and, you know, but then came full circle, and he's the reason we started touring. He came back, and it's a long story, but I met him the very first day, and there was just that feeling. And when I look back, I'm like, wow, like, he was such a pivotal person in my life for why we went the way that we went and why we decided to chance it and give it a shot. You know, if it weren't for him, I might have just gone to college and got a regular job or whatever. So it's moments like that that I think are really important.